with strength of materials. Okay, so yes, so we will go with Young's modulus. Very simple. Students, one thing I want to tell you, whether a stress is a tensor or a scalar or a vector, okay, stress is neither a scalar nor a vector. Let me tell you, it's a tensor. Okay, this is one thing which people do not know. How many of you do not know about this? It's a tensor. Tensor is a different quantity. Okay, the first order tensor is called a vector. Zeroth order tensor is a scalar. Second order tensor, there are various quantities which are second order tensors. Some of the quantities that are second order tensors are stress and strain. These are second order tensors. There are fourth order tensor also, like fourth order tensors, which is like elastic constants. Okay, elastic constant tensor. Okay, so Young's modulus, when you say Young's modulus, is what we know. It is the ratio of direct stress to direct strain, or axial stress to axial strain, or let us put it like that only, ratio of direct stress, not shear stress, or normal stress. You can say, instead of direct, you can say normal stress to normal strain. Simple and straight, correct? Nothing great in that. So it is represented by E, which you know already, correct? So E is actually equal to sigma by epsilon, where epsilon is the strain. So sigma can be written as P by A, correct? And what is delta? What is epsilon? Epsilon is delta L by L, correct? So PL by, PL by A into delta L is the Young's modulus. Now let us see what are the different Young's modulus of some materials, okay? Just to have a idea of this. This comes in ISRO exams generally, students. ISRO or some of the PSU exam. They want students to have an idea of what would be the Young's modulus for different materials. Okay, so there is a list which is there. You can complete that list. Some of the things I will put in the list. Okay, I hope you have written this down. Now let us go further. Now let us see what are the Young's modulus of some materials. This is important, students, of some materials. Okay, so Young's modulus of some materials can be, the highest Young's modulus is there for diamond. You know, it comes, it is formed in the earth's mantle, is it not? It is much below the earth's crust that diamond is formed, is it not? So it has a very high Young's modulus, 1200 GPa. Another one which we have is tungsten. That's why tungsten is used in various composites. Okay, 437 GPa. Okay, some of the examples, others you can have it. Okay, carbon steel is a big thing, right? When you say carbon steel, it's not one, is it not? You have to tell me what is the, it's generally accepted, it's at around 200 GPa. Okay, copper. This is to have an idea, students. Very important that you have this idea. Okay, 120 GPa. Fine. Bronze is having around 110 GPa. It's a copper alloy, correct? Next, cast iron. Just you are adding the number of amount of carbon into it, is it not? So cast iron comes as 100 GPa. Okay, brass is 95 GPa. And aluminium is 70 GPa. So these are some of the examples which is generally used in industry, okay, or application, real application. These are the things you can just see that. Okay, Yeah, students, once you finish writing, then let us go further. Okay, then we will go one by one. Just a second, I'll come. 1 second, students. Yeah, students. Tell me once you have finished writing. These are very, very important concepts. Done? Fine. Let me go further. Okay. Next, we have something called modulus of rigidity, which you know already, right? So I'm going fast here. There might be some additional things sir will say. If he's repeating, then it's no trouble at all. Okay, because he goes to much deeper than what I am going now. Okay, so let him go in that fashion. Okay, so this is additional one. Okay, the ratio of shear stress to shear strain. What is shear stress? I think he will explain it better. Okay, shear stress to shear strain. It will be explained better, students. We are going over the surface now. What is modulus of rigidity? G, shear stress by shear strain. Shear strain, what is shear strain, students? Shear strain is about change in angle, keep in mind. What is shear strain? Shear strain is change in angle of a particular solid component. If there is change in angle, this theta represents the shear strain. Okay. So it's very important that we understand what is shear strain. Okay, it is a ratio of two. It is a ratio of two numbers, right? Two lengths. Okay, delta L by L. Okay, so this is how you can call it, is transverse. Okay, shear stress is there. So G is the shear strain, Newton per meter square divided by shear strain. Correct. So Newton per meter square. Correct? So that's how it is. Next is bulk modulus. We will see much further about bulk modulus in fluid mechanics. Okay, bulk modulus is nothing but, it is given by K. It has relationship with speed of sound in air. Correct. Air's bulk modulus affects sound is because of the elasticity of air. Keep in mind. Okay. So bulk modulus K is given as volumetric stress. It is given as volumetric stress divided by volumetric strain. We will see when we go to fluid mechanics, we will see how volumetric stress and volumetric strain changes. Okay, sorry, volumetric stress divided by volumetric strain. Correct. What is volumetric stress, students? Volumetric stress is nothing but pressure. Volumetric stress is nothing but pressure divided by volumetric strain. This is what is used in von Mises criteria also. Okay, when there is hydrostatic pressure from all the sides, the component does not fail. One of the things what we had in our mind is when we apply a particular stress on a metal, what is going to happen? It is going to break, is it not? But it was seen that the Titanic, which was sunk in Atlantic, had been sunk to such a depth that the amount of stress which is experienced is much higher than the stress which is causing tensile test failure or compressive test failure. UTM experiment, that stress which is there in under the ocean, that stress much exceeds the stress in the in case of tensile test experiment. But still the ship is intact. It has not crumbled into pieces or powder. Okay, we would think that what would happen if there is a high pressure, it would crumble into pieces. That's what we would think, is it not? But that happens only when you have one-sided forces, loads, compressive loads. If the load is from all the sides, that is called hydrostatic stresses, okay, it won't fail. Correct. So what fails is when it is distorted. when there is scope for distortion, only then a particular element fails. Okay, so that is why it is called von Mises stresses, or it is called distortion energy stresses. Okay, so distortion energy, because of distortion energy, whatever the stresses which is caused, or distortion energy principle it is called. Okay, so when the distortion energy in the real component exceeds the distortion energy in the tensile test experiment, the particular component fails. And that is what is von Mises stresses, and that's what you do in CAE lab, is it not? Mechanical engineers do CAE labs, where they put very nice figures of von Mises stress distribution with all the colors, red, green, blue, and all those things, is it not? But people do not know what is von Mises stresses. They think tools is everything. Tools is just like that. Keep in mind, tools are required. I'm not saying tools are not required, but more than tools, what is required is you understand what is going on there. That's important. Okay, so it is the same thing. So K is given as volumetric stress divided by volumetric strain. Very important. Volumetric stress is nothing but pressure divided by volumetric strain is delta V by V. Change in volume divided by original volume. Okay, this is important in air. Okay, because this is what propels the pressure waves. Okay, waves, when it comes, if you say vibration, vibration is a wave, student. Okay, why the wave is caused? If there is a spring which is there, it is left, it is loaded, and say it is left, what will happen? It will oscillate. Why it will oscillate? Because at once the inertia force is more, at the other side the elasticity force is more. It is a balance between inertia force and elasticity force. Same thing happens in pressure forces also, pressure waves also. Okay, so these are some analogies you can have, but the details are much more the reality is much more in detail. Okay, we will see when it comes. Okay, next, students, next one, what is important is Poisson's ratio. Okay, the way I'm pronouncing is not proper. Okay, Poisson's ratio, it is not Poisson's ratio, it's Poisson ratio or something. Okay, I'm not very sure about the pronunciation. I am not worried about it, just like an American is not worried about pronouncing it properly. Okay, he pronounces Indian name in a very, very different way. And I'm a US person has, UK, the person from UK, British person has spoiled all our names. Okay, so what is wrong in spoiling their names, is it not? So we will spoil Poisson, we will say Poisson only, Poisson's ratio. Okay, so the ratio of, because we cannot pronounce their names. Okay, the ratio of, what is it, students, can you tell me? Of lateral strain divided by longitudinal strain. Poisson's ratio is generally represented by nu, can be represented by nu. Okay, there various ways it can be represented. Okay, or mu, let me put it mu only, mu. Okay, mu, I say viscosity, but it's okay, mu, let me put it. Okay, it is lateral strain by longitudinal strain. What does it mean? What do you mean by this? What do you mean by lateral strain divided by longitudinal? What do you mean by lateral strain? Let us understand that. See, in case I have a particular bar, for example, this is one bar, okay, and I am pulling from this side P, I'm pulling here P. Okay, now this, you say it's very small, it's negligible. Okay, fine, it happens on this side also. So when this is pulled, it goes ahead like this, is it not? It goes ahead like this, correct? So it is getting pulled. If I make it straight here, it gets pulled, correct? Now when it is getting pulled, you see there is some reduction in the size here. Okay, this is the length. When there is increase in the length, you will see there is a decrease in the breadth, I can see, right? So there is a small decrease in the breadth. If you observe, there is a small decrease in the breadth, delta B, correct? So what is happening is, this is delta B is in this direction, students, it is like this. Okay, so there's small reduction in the breadth. Okay, so if it is like this, it goes that way. Okay, so it is on this direction, this is getting reduced. So there's a small reduction in the breadth as it is pulled. So this one along the long along, okay, along the force being put, that is called longitudinal strain. And lateral means perpendicular to that is lateral, okay. So Poisson's ratio is nothing but lateral strain by the longitudinal strain. How do we put it here? In this case, mu can be, what is lateral strain? It is delta B by B. What is longitudinal strain? It is delta L by L. So this is delta L, correct? It is delta L by L. That is Poisson's ratio, correct? So it is a material property. It is not, it doesn't depend on how big or how small the component is. What is it based on? It is a material property. So Poisson's ratio is a material property. We can write it here. Poisson's ratio is a material property. This has come a lot of times. Some of the points I will put it, students. Material property. Okay. What is the Poisson's ratio of steel, students? Can you tell me? It's around 0.3, is it not? Okay, so that is one thing. Now, what is the maximum possible Poisson's ratio if you ask? The maximum possible Poisson's ratio is 0.5. Okay, let me put 1 by 1 here. So, points, 1 by 1, we will put the points. Okay, maximum possible Poisson's ratio. Maximum possible Poisson's ratio. Sorry, I'm writing it again. Okay. Poisson's ratio is 0.5. Now, this happens for ideal incompressible material. Okay. So, what is happening? For an ideal incompressible, elastic, incompressible material. Whenever the material is incompressible, example of incompressible thing, you can say water only. Okay, incompressible material. Material whose volumetric strain is zero. Whose volumetric strain is zero. So what is happening when the there is no volumetric strain? That means delta, when it is pulled, there can be volumetric strain, is it not, students? Are you getting that point? In steel and all those things, there are, it's a mixture of carbon as well as iron. Okay, it is a it is like, it's not an incompressible fully, correct? What is happening there? It has a type of structure, and that structure gets lost when it is being pulled. So what is happening? It may occupy some gaps in between, correct? Because how does the steel is there? Steel is either in hexagonally packed. It might be. It might be a. There are a lot of types of crystal arrangements. Is it not, students? So that crystal arrangements. What happens is crystal arrangement, and then there is crystals which is formed. Okay, so molecular arrangement. That atomic arrangement is there on the lowest stage, and then there is a lot of layers which is there. Okay, so what, and also a lot of imperfections. There might be, you may say it's all in a crystalline structure, but it's not always. Okay, when you consider the mild steel or anything, it's not perfectly that. Okay, so when it is pulled, there are a lot of strains which comes. Okay, so because of that, it might not be fully incompressible. Because it is not fully incompressible, the Poisson's ratio is not 0.5. If it is a properly incompressible substance, it would be, what do you mean by incompressible? Incompressible means I will not have delta V by V. When you compress or pull, there is no change, there is no volumetric strain. Okay, if there is no volumetric strain, then the Poisson's ratio is 0.5. very, very important. Okay, now next one, we will make a list, okay, of materials. Materials and Poisson's ratio. We will have material and Poisson's ratio. Cork, okay, has zero Poisson's ratio. That means if you pull, nothing happens on the other side. Okay. Then concrete has 0.1 to 0.2. Okay, glass. This is very, very important, students, to have an idea. Glass varies from 0.2 to 0.27. What happens in ISRO exam, I have seen, they will give you questions like this. Arrange these materials in the increasing order of Poisson's ratio, and then they will have four options. Correct. So whatever the option is right, you have to click. Okay. So you should have an idea of what is the Poisson's ratio for different things. Okay. Cast iron. Okay. Cast iron has a Poisson's ratio of 0.2 to 0.3. Okay. Steel. Steel, when you say it is a low carbon steel, that's what we call. Correct. So steel is from 0.27. So cast iron has a lesser Poisson's ratio than steel. Correct. 2.3. Same thing. Okay. Then aluminium. Aluminium. It is 0.33. Brass. 0.34. Okay. Gold. Gold has 0.44. Next, incompressible materials like clay. Incompressible materials like you can say paraffin. Paraffin wax, you have no rubber, etc., which are incompressible, has a Poisson's ratio of 0.5. Very, very important, students. This might come as one mark, but very, very important. Okay. So the theory, what we are saying, is very, very, very important. Okay. You cannot do anything. You know it, you get know the answer. You don't know it, you don't know the answer. That's it. Okay. It is like GK question. Okay. General knowledge question. Okay. I was actually worried because we are trained engineers. If the mathematics doesn't come, we are worried. Is it not? So, in case of when you consider GK, general knowledge, correct? You have to do this way only. You have to do gossips only. Okay, this is gossiping, right? A type of, okay, saying what is not, right? So you have to remember these things. No other go. Okay. For me, history was very interesting, but there are a lot of people, especially who come to scientific field, they don't like history, correct? So don't like theory in general. Okay, whenever there's mathematics coming, only then you like it. Okay, but it's not so. Okay, fine. You've written this down, students. Fine. Okay. Next, let us see relation between elastic constants. Very important. Sir may add some more things into it, or he may repeat it, which is very fine for me. Okay. And repetition, you have to attend, students, okay? Because there will be some points which he'll add up, okay? Elastic constants. And I will be repeating, don't worry, okay? And again, we will have some other professors also. The same topic, see, the March batch has that advantage that the same topic will be repeated again and again. Because of that repetition, you will have in-depth knowledge of it, okay? And various types of perspectives you will have, okay? So, relation between elastic constants, say E, G, K and mu. These are the elastic constants, correct? These are the four elastic constants what we have now, okay? This is very, very, very important, students. I'm just writing it. It's formula, yes, but very, very important, okay? You can write this, keep it in your mind. Almost every competitive exam, this comes, okay? E is equal to 2 times G. I'm not going with the derivation. There is a derivation for this, okay, but not required. Okay, 2 times G into 1 plus mu. E can also be written as 3K. You have to by heart this, students, okay? 1 minus 2 mu. What is not required, we will not do. What is required, we will do, students. Okay. E is equal to 9 kg. Okay. 9 kg. Divide by G plus 3K. Very, very important, students. Another one, mu can be written as 3K, that is the rigid volumetric bulk modulus, minus 2G divided by 6K plus 2G. Very important, students. Write this down. Important, important, important. Very, very, very important. Fine. Write this down neatly, students. Done? Okay. Next one. Number of elastic constants. So what is happening is, depending on the material, the number of elastic constants to define a material is important. Okay. So number of elastic constants. Number of elastic constants required to specify elastic properties of a material. What is the number of elastic constants required to specify the elastic properties of the material? If it is an isotropic material, what is it? Isotropic material. If it is an isotropic material, then you require only two elastic constants. What does that mean? How many elastic constants we have gone through now? The number of elastic constants we have now is, one is E, one is G, one is K, and the other one is mu. So among E, G, K and mu, if we know only two elastic constants, we can find the other two. So understanding of two or information about two elastic constants is enough if it is an isotropic material. What do you mean by isotropic material? Isotropic material is the one whose properties does not vary in any direction. It is constant all over the material. You take a material, its property is the same, correct? Any part of the material does not change. Then it is called a isotropic material. Okay. Next, orthotropic. We have stopped vocabulary, is it not? In vocabulary, this we will do, students. We will add again. We will start again. Okay, but not tomorrow. Okay. Orthotropic material. Ortho means straight, students. The root of ortho means straight, being straight. Okay, so orthogonal. Ortho means straight angles, correct? So orthotropic material means the properties varies when you go to the perpendicular directions. Example is composites. When you have composites, you have glass fibers, you have fibers, and then you have the binder, right? Or even the best example for a composite is your concrete. Okay, so steel reinforced concrete, okay, RCC. Okay, so here when you have reinforced cement concrete, what happens there is you have the fiber. Instead of fiber, you have those steel rods, is it not? So when you go in a perpendicular directions, there is change in the properties. Those are called orthotropic materials. And when you talk about orthotropic materials, you need 9 elastic constants, not 2. Okay. Another one is anisotropic, which changes like anything. Okay, so anisotropic materials, and it requires how many? It requires 27 elastic constants. If you define 27 elastic constants, then only you can specify the deformation in every part of the anisotropic material. Okay. So now generally what happens, stress is a 9 element tensor, student. Let me put it again, then we will go to the compound stresses. Okay, stress, when you say, How many elements are there in the stress tensor, students? Generally, when you have a vector, for example, if you have an area vector, what does it have? It has a magnitude A and then the constant or the unit vector. So you have magnitude and direction. Correct? You have two things. Okay. Now when you consider stress, what happens is additional one. Which place it is placed? Like if you have a element like this, a small element, okay, infinitesimal element, if you have, it depends on not only on the direction of the stress of the force. Force might be this normal force, tangential force, it might be this. It's not just the force has two things. One is direction as well as magnitude, correct? So this is direction and magnitude is done, but that doesn't define the stress on this element, say ABCD. It does not define the stress on the element ABCD. What you need another side? You have direction, where it is acting, what is the area vector. So you have to have another thing called the area vector into consideration. So in which area it is acting. So there what you have three extra things for everything, correct? So here this all together, when you have a stress at a point, when you consider stress at a point, when you consider stress at a point, there are 9 components for the stress tensor. How many components are there? Stress at a point is a 9 component, is a 9 component tensor. It is a element which has 9 components. Okay. So how is a stress tensor denoted? Stress tensor comes as sigma x in the x direction, force in the x direction divided by the area vector, correct? So stress is force by area, right? Force in the x plane. So if I say this is the x plane, force in the x plane in the x direction, force in the x plane in the x direction. So it is in this direction, it is positive. So divided by area vector. Area vector should have the same direction then only. Okay. Another one. When you consider shear stress is, I can say x, y. It means force in the y direction on the x, force in the y direction on the x plane. On the x plane in the y direction. Similar way, on the x plane in the z direction. The force is in the z direction, it is on the x plane. Similar way, shear stress on y plane in the x direction. Then stress at the y plane in the y direction. Then stress at the y plane in the z direction. Similar way, another one comes is, you have stress in the z direction, in the z plane, in the x direction, stress in the z plane in the y direction, stress in the z plane in the z direction. So this forms the shear, or this forms the stresses. Okay, stress tensor. This whole together is a stress tensor. You cannot take it separately. Okay, I hope you get the point here, students. Any doubts? Write it down and understand. It's very deep. Okay, it's very interesting also. Okay. It can be minus or plus, that we will see it later. Okay. What is positive stresses? What is negative stresses? We will see it later. Okay. Now we will keep it simple. Okay. There is something called KISS. Keep it simple, stupid. KISS. Okay. We will not say stupid. We will say keep it simple and sweet. Okay. We will not talk any expletives. Okay. Fine. I'm weak in English, students. I'm trying to build up my vocabulary. So please pardon me if I don't use words properly. Okay. Fine. Now let us see compound bars. Very simple, students. Today I am taking very, very simple concepts. Okay. Compound bars. Okay. Let us take that. First one in that is bars in series. Bars in series. This is one thing which has come a lot of times in GATE. GATE is a simple exam, keep in mind. Okay. So the way it can come is like this. Okay. First way could be, first type of problems could be like this. There is a bar which is fixed. Okay. There might be different cross sections. There may be different cross section of bar. And there might be different loads acting at different places. You can say P1, you can say P2. Okay, there are different loads acting. Okay. So you can say 1, 2, 3. Okay. Or if that is the case, I can put it P3. Okay. So like this, there are a lot of, or I'll this I'll say P1. Okay. So what is happening? This kind of problem it is. Okay. Now when you have this kind of problem, you have to keep in mind that the total force which is acting, or you can say, okay, let me rub this off. Okay, let me not put this. Okay, let me put it like this only. Only one force, or it is the other force students. Okay, so if this kind of things is there, then what happens? P1. Yeah.
Sir.
Huh. WhatsApp me your problem, this one. You can put a voicemail on the WhatsApp also. You can put the voice. Through voice also you can ask the question. I'll repeat here. If you have doubts, you ask me later. Okay. You put it. Okay. I'll continue the class. Okay. So here, force on 1 is equal to force on 2 is equal to force on 3 is equal to the applied force P. I can say P. Okay. It is the same. Okay. So that is the first case which is there. Now what happens, the elongation, when you say the strain or the elongation, if I see, elongation is said by delta L. Delta L can be PL by AE, correct? Because what is happening, the stress, we have seen that, is it not? E is equal to PL by A into delta L. So delta L is what? PL by AE, correct? So delta L total is equal to P1 L1 by A1 E1 if it is changing, plus P2 L2 by A2 E2 plus P3 L3 divided by A3 E3, correct? So this way we can say the whole thing. This is the first type of problem. Okay, simple. I think I have got the mail. I've got the question. No. Students, if okay, Divya Raj has question.
Like, why is area vector? Could you explain it in the previous
sum? Okay. So he's asking me what is it?
Sir, like I'm a little confused with the area vector. Could you explain it in the previous sum?
Okay, fine.
Fine, Divya.
So I hope students have understood the question. He is asking me to explain area vector. Okay, so area vector, when you say area, how it comes? Area is always a vector, is it not? And here, area vector is perpendicular to the area, correct? This is the area here, correct? The magnitude of area is here. What we have in our mind, that area is a 2D surface, okay? We are now having it as a vector. Okay, so we are not talking about area as a surface, we are talking about area as a vector. Now this particular idea comes in the sense, if I am having this particular book, okay, now what is going towards you can be taken as positive, what is going inside can be taken as negative. Okay, so this is one of the way we can understand the area which is facing you can be considered positive, what is backwards can be considered negative. That's it. Nothing great in that. Okay. And it can be done by, I think I have another question from you. Just a second. No. Fine. No, it is somebody else. Okay. So here, what is happening? The area vector goes like this. I hope, Divya, you have understood that. Okay, I'll open up the chat. Okay, so you can put it in the chat, Divya. In the chat box, you can put it. Okay, whatever your question is. Fine, you're clear with that? Diviraj, you're clear? Okay then, let me go further. If you have doubts, you can put it. Okay, don't worry. I think you have a problem with your mic, correct? So it's okay. So what is happening? This is the bars in series. Okay. Now there might be a case where, now one more point we have to understand. So sometimes we call prismatic bars. What do you mean by prismatic bars? What do you mean by prismatic bars? Okay. It means prismatic bar means uniform cross section, very important. Sometimes we worry about what is that. Okay. Uniform cross section and made out of same material. And made out of same material. If it is a uniform cross section made out of same material, then it is called a prismatic bar. I hope you understand this, students. Okay, fine. Next one. Next type of question that might come is like this. You will have a thing like this, and then you have forces in between. Okay, there is a thing like this, and here you may have forces in between. For example, I'll have this as section 1, section 2 and section 3, and I may have a force 2P here, a force 2P here, and then I'll have a force P here. So now if this is the case, this is the way you have, then what you have to do is you have to draw the free body diagrams. Okay, so let us see how to draw the free body diagrams for this. Okay, so yeah, so
how should we practically imagine this? How can we practically imagine this? How can we the load supplied in particular sections?
Okay, it can be practically, it can be done if you have a hooks, for example. Correct, these are all idealization. Keep in mind, if you say actual case, it is not so much. We as an engineers, we have to idealize things, and it is almost clear, correct. Okay, so if you may think about a particular bar with some hooks, correct, we may consider this bar, okay, having some hooks on the side, correct. You may think like that. Okay, there might be some hooks here, and over the hook something would be loaded. Okay, and over here something else would be loaded, that would come as P. Here the hook which is there is P, and there might be something else, there might be other load which is coming here, which is held, for example. Or maybe due to some gripper might be there, which is holding it and pulling it up. Possible. Correct. So these are the various cases which it can have. Okay. See, actually in engineering, when you go to engineering applications, okay, real industrial applications, whatever we are studying now is very much required. Everything comes into effect. Okay, some people say, sir, whatever we are teaching, learning is outdated, sir. When we go to industry, it is not useful. No. This is what is the base. If you are not strong in the base in industry, you will crack like anything. Okay, you cannot understand anything what they say. Okay, I do agree that in industry there are advanced things. Okay, it is much more advanced than what we teach in engineering. I don't have any problem in telling this. Okay, industry, specific industries, it's very, very big. Okay, and the amount of knowledge is huge. But let me tell you, without you doing the basics, that cannot be got. Okay, your base is this. If you don't develop the base, you cannot build a superstructure. Superstructure will fall like anything and it will not sustain. Okay, then you will work as a manager, or you will work as a worker. Only two things: as a manager or a worker. Manager, if you have other soft skills, you'll work as a manager. If you don't have a soft skill, then you'll work as a coolie. But you'll not work as an engineer, let me tell you. You'll not work as an engineer. Engineer's work is different from a managerial work and different from a worker. Okay, the labor type of thing. Okay, I call it coolie only, don't worry. Okay, so it's apart from that, you apply your engineering knowledge into it. Correct? I see this engineering work can be in quality control. It can be in, R&D. R&D is the best place where you get the engineering work. Or maintenance also. You don't know what is going wrong. Some big machinery has failed. You cannot, if you don't have the basics of engineering, if you don't have skills of engineering, you cannot solve that problem. You cannot find the fault in that machine, correct? And you have to recommend it in a proper way. So that also has knowledge, okay? It needs a tremendous knowledge to tell that, okay? Where is the proper cause? And people respect the engineers who can see the flaw properly. Okay, we have a particular instance about Vishweshwaraya. Okay, he was going in a train, it seems, and when he was sleeping, he saw that the vibration sound of the track was something different. Okay, and he went to the driver, maybe he pulled the chain or something like that. He stopped the train anyhow, somehow. And the people asked, what happened? Why did you stop the train? He said, somewhere on the track, there is a crack that the train may delay. And he was right. Okay. So this intuitive understanding, this comes by practice. Okay. It doesn't come just like that. You may see some doctors telling just like that what is the problem. Correct. So it comes by practice. Practice is the main thing, students. Karata karata abhyas. I say again and again. Correct. So now here, in this case, what happens? If I consider P1, we don't know what is the forces acting. How can we get the forces? We will see. Don't start from this end. Okay, start from the free end, student. Okay, so P2, we will see it later. Okay, we will have to start from which end? We have to start from the free end. This is very, very important here. This is what people will fail. So what happens if you start from other end? It will go wrong. You have to start from the free end. So free end, when you say the load P is acting, we know it, correct? So what would be it here? It would be P over here, correct? So now this P and this P. Now this end is over here. This end is over here. So P is acting. What it has to happen when you add these two, when you join these two, what it is, it has to result? It has to result in 2P force, is it not? So we will have a P here in this direction. Observe how to write the free body diagram, correct? So what is happening? This P, additional one, will come here. So this P and this P, when you join it together, just like Lego bricks, you are adding it up. You have this P and other P adding up together, and you have the 2P acting over here. Correct, students? You see 2P acting over here. Correct? Now, similar way, now this P is acting. Now, it has to be in equilibrium. Correct? So if it has to be in equilibrium, sigma V is equal to 0. Sigma force of horizontal force is equal to 0. That means this side, it has to act P. Easy? So if it is P on this side, if it is P on this side, here you see. Now this is what? This is equivalent to this side. Correct? Understand this. Go slow. Initially go slow and then you will understand. This P acts over here. So it is P on this side and it has to become 2P here. So the same side, it has to be P. Correct? Intuitively I am telling you, I am not using equations here. Why I am not using equations? You should not use equations here. You should use this simple thinking. Okay? If you use the equation, you will get it, no doubt. Here you say sigma FH is equal to 0 and then you will get it, okay? And at this point, you say method of nodes you can have and then you can calculate this P, correct? But not required, correct? So this is mine. This is the way I solve this kind of problems. I hope it's clear, students. How do we solve? Write this down, okay? And then we solve everything. So what is the delta total? Delta total in a sense, deformation, total deformation. Delta L total is delta L1 plus delta L2 plus delta L3, and that we can get it as P1 L1 by A1 E1. It may change, is it not? Every part may have different materials also. Okay, P2 L2 by A2 E2 plus P3 L3 by A3 E3. Correct, students? I hope you get this point. Okay, write this down. Tomorrow we will repeat this. We will continue this bars and then we will do thermal stresses. Okay. which comes a lot. This is a common question in GATE students. Okay, these are common questions. Okay, it has been repeated a lot of times, not just in GATE, in other competitive exams also. Okay, fine. Shall we continue? Yes. Now next, let us do a problem. The problem is something like this. Okay, we have a a bigger one. Okay, a bigger bar. It is having 300 millimeter square cross-sectional area. Then there is a smaller bar. Okay, and this smaller bar is connected, is fixed, maybe through concrete or anything. It is fixed, okay, or welded into some places. We are not sure, but it is fixed. Okay, and this is having 50 millimeter square. What is it? It is 50 millimeter square. And then there is another one with 100 millimeter square. Not to scale, students, kindly do not scale this. It is not scalable. Okay, figures not to scale. Okay, 100 millimeter square. And then we have a load of 10 kilonewton over here, and then I have to have a length, is it not? This length is 500 millimeter, each length is 500 millimeters. Very simple one. And then I have the same thing, 500 millimeters. So that's why I said not to scale, okay, because I drew this smaller. Okay, now the question is, another side, okay, you have in addition to this, we have here a force being applied which is equal to 5 kilonewton, and then another force is applied over here, maybe due to various reasons. Okay, it is 12 kilonewton. Okay, so 5 kilonewton over here and 12 kilonewton over here. Correct, students? Now tell me, what are the loads in each section? Shall we do that? So first, if I say this is first one, the second one, this is the third one, let us see that. So on the first one, if you see, what will happen? On the first one, you have 10 kilonewton on this side, correct? So if it has to be equivalent, then what happens? It is this side which has to be 10 kilonewton. Simple. Next one. If you consider this, the second portion here, okay, second portion, this is the first portion, this is the second portion. What is the second portion force, can you tell me, students? How will it act? It is 5 kilonewton on this side.
15 kilonewton tensile.
Exactly, both side tensile 15 kilonewton. Very good. So it is tensile 15 kilonewton on both sides. Easy, convinced? And what about the third one? Third one would be, yeah, tell me about the third one, students. How much it would be? I want everybody to be clear on this, okay?
Three kilonewtons tensile.
Very correct. Super. So it is 3 kilonewton tensile. That's it. So can you tell me in these three, which is the weakest section? Determine the weakest section, students. Now, what do you mean by weakest section? Weakest section is the one which has the maximum stress. What is the weakest section? Which has the maximum stress. What is the stress here? Stress is 10 by 100. Okay. And what about here? 15 by 300. And what about this? 3 by 50. Tell me which is the biggest, students, out of this. This one, is it not? 10 by 100 is 0.1, I will see. We will not worry about the units, correct? And what about this? This is 15 by 300. 15 by 300 is 0.05, is it not? Other units we will see it later. Okay, 3 by 50 is much higher than that, is it not? It is 0.06, correct? 0.06, correct? No. So that is the things we have. So we have, this is the weakest section. Easy, students? Any doubts here? Fine. So we will stop the class now, students. Tomorrow we will go with much more problems in this fashion. If you have any doubts, you can tell me, ask me now. Yes, students, do you have any doubts on this? No doubts?
In the second section, I didn't get how it is 15 kilonewton.
Very good. Okay. So, good that you have asked. Okay. So, now here what happens is, see here, where does this go? This is section. I'll say this is A, this is B, this is C, and this is D. So, this is A, this is B. What is B here? B is this. So, when you add this and this, because they are the same thing, is it not? This B section here and this B section here is the same. So when you add these two, you have to have 5 on the which is pointing towards the left, is it not? When it will have, when you have 10 here, 15 here, what is the addition? 5 on the this side, so you'll get this. What about this here, 15 here? What it has to have? It has to have 12 kilonewton. So 15 here, 3 on the other side, what is equivalent? 12 kilonewton. I hope you get that. Sharon, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Very good.